All right, now I wanted to address guns in the media. Now, a lot of pro-gun people get the impression and will say that there's a media bias against guns in the media. And while that's certainly sometimes the case, I think the more important issue when it comes to the media isn't about bias, it's just about the incentives of reporting. And what I mean by that is that when it comes to guns in society, the very negative aspects of guns are going to have a far more disproportional viewing, especially in the national media, than the positive aspects of gun ownership. So, and this is epitomized in the media saying, if it leads, it bleeds. If you're about to be assaulted by somebody and you pull out a gun and they run away, it's not a story. It's an interesting phenomenon. It's very common. It happens hundreds of times every day, at least. But it's not a story. And you can't really fault the media for not reporting it. For one thing, it's not reported. Usually when this happens, it's not reported to anybody. The person who brandishes a weapon to scare away an assailant is not likely to tell the authorities, at least, let alone the media. They might not tell anybody. And so you can't really fault them for not covering it. The other thing is it's not news. And so the main issue with the media and guns is that for those who don't look at studies of how often guns are used defensively, they have a skewed perspective and perception of the role of guns in society. So if you base your ideas on how guns are used in society on the nightly news, then the only thing that you know that guns are used for is for mass shootings. When there is a mass shooting, you hear about it. And if it's a big mass shooting, you hear about it all the time. Virginia Tech, Columbine, the Tucson. That's new. That's front page news for many days or even weeks. And I'm not saying that's bad. The thing is on the day of the Tucson shooting, guns were probably used defensively hundreds, probably even a few thousand times. And even if only a tiny, tiny percentage of those resulted in actually saving the life of the potential victim, even only 1%, it would have represented more lives saved than were killed. But none of that was in the news. And that's not because the people who make the news are biased, although some of them clearly are, but it's just it doesn't make sense to report something like that. And then the other thing is in cases where an assailant is killed or, you know, those sometimes will get reported on, but usually only in the local media. So if you go on YouTube or you do Google searches, you know, say a person shoots burglar or person uses gun, that happens several times a week, at least, maybe even every day, where it does get reported, but it will be in the local news. Be in local newspapers, on local TV stations. It's not going to be in the national news. And I mean, if it was in the national news, they'd have to be talking about it for half the broadcast every night. And as a gun proponent, I guess I'd like that, but I certainly understand how that would never happen. So when you're talking to people, it really helps to understand why they have this anti-gun bias. And that's one of the reasons, because they only hear about them in the context of the mass shootings. They don't hear about how often they're used defensively. And a lot of times, when you tell them, and no one knows for sure, but there are estimates, they're as scientific as they can be, they are indignant. They think you're lying. Why isn't the news reporting on Gary Kleck's studies all the time? Well, because Gary Kleck's studies are, you know, dry academic, you know, topics that don't have any, you know, byline of someone getting killed or a whole bunch of people getting killed. And so it's not going to get reported on. Now, there are some reporters who do have a bias. And I've seen several times where they'll do stories on, well, they're focused on the gun issue, and they're emotive usually. I remember Diane Sawyer made one called If I Only Had a Gun, and basically it alleged that having a gun for personal protection is useless. Is useless. Then, and the way that they proved this was with a reenactment where they had like three SWAT guys who were expert marksmen who would storm into a classroom where they knew the person who had a gun. They had like paintball handguns, and they stormed in and they killed this person, shot them with the paintballs before the person was able to stop them. That's a ridiculous situation. The whole point of having a concealed weapon is that the assailants don't know who has one. So I can't help but to me the test is doomed to failure to the point where it's obviously was conceived in that way. And you see this a couple times, but I have to say in the United States it's not nearly as bad as it is in other countries. I remember hearing in Australia when they were making, back in 1996, 97, after the Port Arthur massacre, when they were basically, the Prime Minister there, I think, Howard, was basically implementing much stricter gun restrictions. I guess there were a lot of gun owners in Australia who opposed this and who had, rallies and marches. And the thing is that the media in Australia completely ignored these. And so if you watch the news in Australia, they never said, oh, thousands of pro-gun demonstrators, demonstrated in Melbourne or where. They just completely ignored it and acted like it didn't happen. And we only know about these events because of the people who were there, subsequently would talk about it, but basically you can't read a news article about them or see any video of them. Also, when they'll debate, a lot of times they will have basically one person who wants a complete ban on all guns and the criminalization of anybody who even wants to own them, and then somebody else who just wants full registration and a ban on most types of guns and restrictions on carry, but they don't want to throw everyone in jail who ever touched one. In the United States, at least you'll have an NRA person or a GOA person, usually. And even though 5-minute media segments on TV are not the best format for meaningful discussion, at least they get their word out. And so when I watch stuff in the BBC, usually it's pretty horrible, and you can tell that there are people in the United States media who also are biased, but it's a lot. They can't pretend that there aren't. They can't pretend that everybody who's for guns is an ignoramus or has no reason or logic on their side. John Lott wrote a book about, I think it was called Straight Shooting, about media bias in guns, and he pointed out that even in famous shootings, they get a lot of coverage. If a gun is used by a private citizen to stop the shooting, very often that will not be reported or will be underreported. And his quintessential example is the Appalachian School of Law, where a student came, shot a few people, then he was stopped by two other, I think one was a faculty, one was a student, who had guns in their cars. And of the hundreds and hundreds of stories about this, only 1 or 2% mentioned that private citizens with guns were involved. In fact, some of them were misleading, and they said, well, he was tackled, but they, And I guess Lott actually contacted some of these reporters, and a lot of the times they said, well, we can only have 500 words or whatever, and I guess that's plausible. But some of them actually said, well, we didn't want to encourage people to think that guns were okay. This isn't specific to guns, though. If you think that anybody is perfectly objective, you're wrong. And it's one of the big mistakes people make to imagine that just because somebody's on the news or in the media, they're somehow objective. Nobody can be perfectly objective. Everybody has a bias, and it's always good for people to realize that, and where possible to know what that bias is. And if you don't, at least take everything you hear with a grain of salt. And the media, I think, a lot of times perpetuates this myth because they pretend like they're just reporting the news. And some, that doesn't mean they're purposely lying, but and like in that case where they decided not to report on the gun use to prevent a gun tragedy or a mass shooting, that was just their bias sneaking in. They didn't even, it didn't occur to them. You know, they weren't paid by the Brady campaign. It's not like they're in collusion. They just, you know, their bias came through in the reporting. And you need to be aware of that. And that's not just for guns. That's for everything. So there is a bias, but most of it is just the incentives of reporting. It doesn't make sense to spend all night talking about all the times people used a gun for self-defense and nothing happened. I mean, when you do that, there's no crime. There's no body, there's no blood, usually. In 99.9% of the cases, nobody dies. And so it's not news. And so you just have to tell people, hey, this stuff is underreported. It's not a conspiracy. It's just the way it is. And also, a lot of times, when people use guns in self-defense, they won't tell anybody. But even the fraction that do and the fraction that... gets reported and then gets reported in the local media, just that tiny fraction of a fraction outweighs all the mass shootings by many, many times, dozens or hundreds of times. I mean, since Tucson, if you go on YouTube and type, you know, gun used in self-defense, and then, you know, set the time to the last month, you're gonna find more than nine. You're gonna find hundreds. And those are only the tiny percentage that are reported and then are in the media, and then the media that ends up getting on YouTube, which of course isn't all of it. So I just thought I'd touch on it briefly because it's a big part of the anti-gun bias is a result of the fact that the negative aspects are disproportionately overreported, and the positive aspects are not only underreported, they're basically not reported on. So, all right, that's it for now.